High Bridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beyond Measure, The Hidden History of Measurement from Cubits to Quantum Constants, by James Vincent. Read by James Vincent.
Introduction: Why Measurement Matters. The very first measurement, like the first word or first melody, is lost to time, impossible to localize and difficult even to imagine. Yet it was a hugely significant act, another addition to that nest of primeval consciousness that grew in the brains of our ancestors hundreds of thousands of years ago, and that would eventually set us apart from the other animals of the plane. For measurement, like speech and play, is a cornerstone of cognition. It encourages us to pay attention to the boundaries of the world, to notice where the line ends and the scales tip. It requires that we compare one portion of reality to another and describe the differences, creating a scaffold for knowledge. Measurement is the root of all tectonic arts, enabling construction and urban living, and the beginning of quantitative science. If we could not measure, then we could not observe the world around us, could not experiment and learn. Measurement allows us to record the past, and by doing so, uncover patterns that help predict the future. And finally, it is a tool of social cohesion and control, letting us coordinate individual effort into something greater than the sum of its parts. Measurement has not only made the world we live in, it has made us too. I first began to realize the importance of measurement when writing about the redefinition of the kilogram as a journalist in 2018. I had traveled to Paris for the assignment and there interviewed scientists who had been working on the project for decades as part of the International Bureau of Weights and Measures, the organization that oversees the metric system. They explained how, since the 18th century, the kilogram had been defined as the weight of a particular lump of metal, an actual physical artifact kept under lock and key in an underground vault in France. Every weight in the world, even the non-metric ones, could be traced back to this single standard, to the kilogram, or le grand K, as it was known to its keepers. Advances in technology, though, meant the kilogram no longer met society's demand for precision. And so scientists had committed to redefining its value using fundamental constants of nature, derived not from base matter, but from quantum properties buried deep in the foundations of reality. What was more, they had already carried out the same substitution for every other metric unit in existence. Length, temperature, time, and more, all had been silently redefined by this international conspiracy of measurement. The existence of this hidden world was a revelation. I felt like I had opened the door of my flat one morning, only to step out onto the surface of an alien planet, surrounded suddenly by strange trees and the cries of unfamiliar animals. The idea that something as fundamental and commonplace as a unit of measurement was even capable of change was thrilling. And the more I learned, the more questions I had. Why is a kilogram anyway? Why an inch? Who first decided these values, and who maintains them now? As I followed these breadcrumbs, I began to understand what an intellectual feast measurement truly is, what a banquet of historical, scientific, and sociological wonder. The roots of measurement are entangled with those of civilization, traceable back to the ancient Egyptians and Babylonians. It was these societies that first learned to apply consistent units in construction, trade, and astronomy, building towering monuments to gods and kings, and mapping the stars with their newfound power. As units of measurement developed, they became a tool of authority, claimed as the prerogative of the powerful, who used measurement to organize the world to their liking. Similarly, the science of creating accurate measurements, metrology, is entwined with some of the greatest breakthroughs in our understanding of the natural world, and has helped to redefine our place in the cosmos many times over. More than this, measurement is a mirror to society itself. It is a form of attention that reveals what we value in the world. To measure is to choose, to focus your attention on a single attribute and exclude all others. The word precision itself comes from the Latin precisio, meaning to cut off. And so, by examining how and where measurement is applied, we can investigate our own impulses and desires. As it stands today, the world around us is the product of countless acts of measurement, their presence rendered invisible by their ubiquity. If you were reading these words on the page or on a screen, their finished form would be the product of careful weighing and counting. The pulp that forms the paper was made using a chemical mix finely calibrated to tease apart the wood's fibrous cells without destroying their structure. The resulting sheets were forced through gigantic metal rollers of staggering precision, squeezed to the consistent thickness you now feel between your fingers. They were cut and bound to a familiar size before being packed, weighed, and shipped around the world. Even the font used to render these words is the product of careful measurement, every serif pruned, the gaps between each pairing of letters nudged into equilibrium. But since you are listening to this as an audiobook, it's the digital signal that has been trimmed, equalized, and compressed to sound as pleasing as possible. Regardless of whether we think about it or not, measurement is suffused throughout the world, an ordering principle that affects not only what we see and touch, but also the often intangible guidelines of society, from clocks and calendars to the rewards and punishments of work. Measurement is not an intrinsic feature of the world, but a practice invented and imposed by humanity. The earliest evidence for what we might describe as measurement comes in the form of animal bones carved with notches. These metrological relics include the Ashango bone, a baboon fibula between 18,000 and 20,000 years old, and the wolf bone, older still, at roughly 33,000 years in age. Reading their meaning is like any augury, indefinite and intuitive, but archaeologists think the ordering of marks on these bones might make them tally sticks, the first formal measuring tools. In the case of the wolf bone, its incisions are divided into groups of five, a common boundary in many numeral systems. Cultures from around the world tend to count by marking 1, 2, 3, 4, and then striking, slashing, or hooking a line for 5. Psychological studies suggest this is something close to an innate cognitive limit, a natural partition in human thought, though one that is far from impermeable. When tested on our ability to count at a glance, humans can usually take in 3 or 4 items at most. More than that, and we need to start consciously numbering. We need to measure. These notched bones, then, may mark the moment, repeated many times around the world, that our species' ambition exceeded the capacity of our brains and we reached for external support. They show when we began to measure the world around us and, as a result, understand it better. Knowing what phenomena were recorded by these artifacts would help us decipher the place of measurement in our early cognitive development. But without written records, we can only speculate as to their purpose. Perhaps the tally on the wolf bone was kept by a hunter who wanted to strengthen the connection with their prey by using its bones to count their kills. Perhaps they were tracking the passage of time, with each mark representing a single day. If so, then the total number of notches, 55, is near enough double a lunar month, a unit that existed in the movements of our solar system before humans ever named it. If this is the case, then it means the bones might have recorded a sacred activity rather than a profane one, as such cosmological measures are entwined with ideas of the divine and spiritual in ancient societies. Monitoring the coming and going of the seasons was a way for early humans to engage with the life-giving rhythms of the natural world, as well as a first step to taking control over them. The first calendar humans ever established would have been the calendar of seasons, marking the passage of time via animal migration and the appearance of certain flowers and crops. It seems quite certain that humans are the only creatures to develop a formal system of measurement. We know that many species, from rats to raccoons, have an understanding of quantity and are able to distinguish between bigger and smaller piles of food, while other animals carry out feats that surely require some intuitive form of reckoning. Think about the astounding journeys made by birds across continents, orientating themselves using methods not fully understood by science. But these skills are limited in scope, and indeed, studies of children suggest that measurement, like writing and counting, is a cultural skill rather than an intuition we are born with. In one study from 1960, children between the ages of 4 and 10 were shown an 80-centimeter tower of blocks on a table and asked to build a tower of identical size a little distance away. While they were working on the task, a screen was placed between their tower and the original, stopping them directly comparing the two. To solve the puzzle, the youngest children, no older than 4 or 5 years old, eyeballed the job. They looked at the first tower, then started building their own approximate copy. The next cohort, children up to the age of 7, decided that visual comparison was not enough and used their bodies as measuring sticks. They held up their arms, hands, and fingers to the two towers and compared their heights against their own. At this age, some children also decided, quite understandably, that the game was rigged, and simply ignored the instructions and built their tower next to the original. The oldest group, children aged 7 and over, turned to external measures, using strips of paper and sticks they had been provided as makeshift rulers. And even among these, there were subtle differences. Younger children were happiest using paper and sticks the same height as the towers, while older individuals were comfortable using smaller items that could be counted as subdivisions of the whole. Studies like this suggest not only that measurement is a skill we acquire with age, but that a key component of this practice is our ability to abstract. It's not enough to simply compare one tower to another or use a measuring tool the same height as the target. We must instead create an intermediary, a unit of measure that represents nothing but its own value and provides a convenient medium for transferring information from one domain to another. There's some suggestion that our ability to process number in this way is part of a larger cognitive trade-off made long ago in our evolutionary past. Evidence comes from our closest genetic relative, the chimpanzee, who displays a remarkable facility with certain sorts of number tasks. With the right training, a chimp can be shown the numbers 1 to 10 on a screen for just a fraction of a second before tapping the now hidden digits in the correct order, doing so much faster and more accurately than humans. In fact, chimps can complete this task even if the numbers only appear for as little as 210 milliseconds. This is less time than it would take your eye to move around the screen, which suggests the skill being called upon is not a grasp of number as we understand it, but eidetic memory, the ability to retain complex visual information after brief exposure. It's a fantastical ability, the sort we might associate with savants, but it has its own limitations. The same chimps that can perform these feats are unable to replicate other basic numeracy skills, like matching groups of items larger than 4 or 5 with the correct number, even after years of training. Researchers behind this work theorize that some common ancestor of both chimps and humans possessed an eidetic memory, which would have been just the thing for identifying threats in a jungle environment. In a flash, you could take in a tangle of leaves, vines, roots, bark, flowers, fruits, and teeth, identifying a potential predator and raising the alarm. At some point, though, evolutionary forces nudged a group of our ancestors into trading their souped-up memory for other cognitive aptitudes, including, we think, the ability to process language, to socialize and learn from one another. These were the cognitive tools that would allow measurement to flourish, helping to construct the systems that now sustain so much of modern life. It was the 19th century British physicist William Thomson, better known as Lord Kelvin, who offered one of the most memorable summaries of the contribution of measurement to human knowledge. "When you can measure what you are speaking about and express it in numbers, you know something about it," said Thomson. "But when you cannot express it in numbers, your knowledge is of a meager and unsatisfactory kind. It may be the beginning of knowledge, but you have scarcely in your thoughts advanced to the stage of science." Thomson's words epitomize a sort of metrological triumphalism, a confidence in the power of number to square the untidy mysteries of the universe and tame the unknown through calculation. It is a reasonable belief given the history of the sciences, where accurate measurement has time and time again proved itself a prerequisite for experiment and a spur to discovery. Thomson's own groundbreaking work in thermodynamics and electromagnetism relied heavily on just such accurate observations. But this connection can be traced back much further to the discipline of ancient astronomy, a profession that blends what we would now categorize as mysticism and empiricism. In Babylonia, a Mesopotamian kingdom that emerged around 1894 BC, the gods were believed to be regular, if oblique, communicators, bestowing everything from animal entrails to the colour of a dog that urinates on a man with divine import. But the heavens were thought to provide a particularly authoritative format, with the ubiquity and clarity of the stars and planets constituting a celestial PA system that broadcast far and wide. Changes in the night sky might warn of impending disaster, of disease, flood, or invasion, or they might herald a time of peace, the birth of a long-wished-for child, or the start of a profitable trading arrangement. To decode these messages, Babylonian astronomers created detailed records of celestial movements in the heavens, using the resulting tables to sieve out irregularities and, with them, the favour of the gods. This was the kernel of what we now call the scientific method, a demonstration that accurate observations of the world could be used to forecast its future. The importance of measurement in this sort of cosmic comprehension did not develop smoothly over the centuries. Indeed, in the Middle Ages in Europe, reckoning with hand and eye was sometimes seen as producing a rather shabby sort of knowledge, inferior to that of abstract thought. This suspicion was due to the influence of ancient Greeks in the era's scholasticism, particularly Plato and Aristotle, who stressed that the material world was one of unceasing change and instability, and that reality was best understood by reference to immaterial qualities, be they Platonic forms or Aristotelian causes. It would take the revelations of the scientific revolution to fully displace these instincts, with observations of the night sky once again proving decisive. Consider, for example, the unlikely patron saint of patient measurement, that is the 16th century Danish nobleman Tycho Brahe. By most accounts, Brahe was an eccentric, possessed of a huge fortune. His uncle Jorgen was one of the wealthiest men in the country. A metal nose, he lost the original in a duel, and a pet elk, which allegedly died after drinking too much beer and falling down the stairs of one of his castles. After witnessing the appearance of a new star in the night sky in 1572, one of the handful of supernova ever seen in our galaxy, Brahe devoted himself to astronomy. Ancient wisdom and religious doctrine held that the heavens were immutable, but Brahe castigated such blind watchers of the sky. The new star plainly proved otherwise, and he spent decades compiling detailed and precise astronomical records in a purpose-built observatory named Uraniborg. It was the data collected here that would allow Brahe's apprentice, the visionary German astronomer Johannes Kepler, to derive the first mathematical laws of astronomy, the three laws of planetary motion, which correctly described the elliptical orbits of the planets and treated the occupants of our solar system as ordinary matter rather than divine or ethereal substance. It was measurement, then, that focused this new sort of attention on the cosmos, uncovering eternal truths that it would eventually displace the verities of the Church. By the time we reach Lord Kelvin, the power of measurement has proven its supremacy not just through scientific knowledge, but also its industrial application. In the 19th century, it was precision engineering that transformed the steam engine from a leaky and inefficient machine to the high-pressure muscle of the Industrial Revolution. While the ability to accurately measure and meter electricity allowed for its commercial application in lighting, communication, and more. This was the century in which the factory replaced the farm as the backbone of a nation's wealth, in which telegraph lines connected continents and X-rays illuminated the interior of the human body. The 1800s may have begun under the flicker of torch and gaslight, but they ended with a blaze of electricity, all advances that owed at least something to measurement, and would only accelerate in the years that followed. The calculations of Kepler are sometimes thought of as the first natural laws of science, in that they are unchanging, precise, and verifiable. Their authority is a product of their universality. Their predictions are applicable not just to this planet at this time, but to all planets across time and space. In other words, they are generalized, abstract rules, qualities essential to the development of measurement. Indeed, if you were to summarize the history of measurement in a single sentence, it would be as a history of increasing abstraction. Measurement begins life rooted in the particulars of human experience, but over time has become increasingly detached from our life and labor. Just as with Kepler's laws, the result is that it has attained authority over an ever-expanding domain. As the children who measured towers in that 1960s study demonstrate, the first tools of measurement we turn to are our own bodies. Common units like the hand and foot are still in use today, while others are at least familiar, like the cubit, the length from the elbow to the fingertip, and fathom, the span of your outstretched arms. Some cultures have created particularly rich indexes of measure from the human body. The Aztecs not only had equivalents of the cubit and fathom, but also units based on the forearm alone, the omital, the tip of the hand to the armpit, the quiactal, and the tip of the finger to the shoulder, the acali. The Maori have derived at least 12 units from the body, from the smallest, the konui, equal to the first joint of the thumb, to the largest, the takoto, which measures the full length of the body with both arms raised above the head. Many of these measures have been superseded by standardized units, but survive in an informal sense. We may have forgotten the Epson, for example, a Middle English unit equivalent to a pair of cupped hands, but we still dole out food and ingredients by the pinch and the mouthful. Using our bodies to measure the world makes intuitive sense. It is a scale appropriate to human activity, and means that measuring tools are always at hand. The same logic applied to many other pre-modern measures, which were defined by the expediencies of everyday life. This often meant they were elastic in their values, shrinking or expanding with the environment. Consider the old Finnish unit of length known as the peninkulma, which was originally measured as the distance at which a dog's bark could be heard, around 6 kilometres. Such a unit would be imprecise, changing in length based on the type of land being measured, how far a dog's bark travels through dense forests versus open valleys. But this flexibility offers its own store of information, giving some indication of terrain and accessibility. This aspect of measurement is most clearly demonstrated in medieval land units, which varied based on similar agricultural factors. The old Irish unit of the collop, for example, was defined as the amount of land needed to graze a single cow. Here is a unit that adapts to the practicalities of life, meaning lush, energy-dense pasture would be measured in smaller collops than the same area of barren hillside. In the 1942 Irish novel The Tailor and Anstey by Eric Cross, the character of the tailor uses the collop to demonstrate the wisdom of his forebears. An acre might be an acre of rock, but you know where you are with a collop, he says, disparaging a neighbour who boasts of owning 4,000 acres but only has enough real land to graze 4 cows. To illustrate this ancient practicality, he describes a unit of time based on the lifespan of the rail, a family of birds that includes the moorhen and the coot. A hound outlives 3 rails, a horse outlives 3 hounds, a jock outlives 3 horses, a deer outlives 3 jocks, an eagle outlives 3 deer, a yew tree outlives 3 eagles, an old ridge in the ground outlives 3 yew trees, says the tailor. No larger units of time are needed, he adds, as 3 ridges is as long as from the beginning to the end of the world. As the science writer Robert P. Creese has calculated, if a rail lives for a decade, then this reckoning puts the age of the universe at 65,610 years. That's nothing compared to the modern estimates of around 14 billion years, but close to the estimates of the Middle Ages. As the tailor says, the reason old units are superior is obvious. They were reckoned on the things a man could see about him so that wherever he was, he had an almanac. The descriptive capacity of units had practical benefits, flowing to fit the contours of labour and land. Their use seems part of a worldview that prioritised locality and tradition. But as society grew more interconnected, these measures created problems. If neighbouring regions used different units, or worse, the same units with different values, it stymied trade. Metrological dialects also reduced citizens' legibility, making it difficult for centralised governments to assess and tax the wealth of the people. Corruption too flourished with variable measures. Manorial lords, for example, would collect their feudal dues using capacity measures of grain larger than those used in markets and mills. When their dependents were cheated, what authority could they turn to? An absence of standardised measures created a power vacuum that was easy to exploit. It was these factors that contributed to the single most significant event in the history of measurement, the creation of the metric system. This project, which took place during the final years of the 18th century alongside the French Revolution, was both symbol and instantiation of the era's politics. The metric system was designed by the country's intellectual elite, the savants, to reflect the era's ideals. They thought that the standardization of weights and measures would eliminate some of the imbalances of feudal life, complementing the political equality of republicanism. To remove measurements from the vagaries of work and environment, they decided to base their units on what they considered to be an impersonal and incorruptible arbiter, the earth itself. Many of the age's greatest intellects contributed to what would be a 7-year project to measure the planet and define the new unit of length, the meter. This would eventually be standardized as 1/10,000,000th of the distance from the North Pole to the equator, with the accompanying mass standard, the kilogram, equal to the weight of a cubic decimeter of water. That's a cube with sides 1/10 of a meter in length. These new units, as much the product of revolutionary tribunals as scientific calculation, would be universally accepted, said the savants, because they were abstracted from human affairs, impartial and unchanging. These abstractions would, eventually, lead to the global adoption and domination of the metric system. As the historian Eric Hobsbawm noted, metric units are in some ways the most lasting and universal consequence of the French Revolution. By helping transform measurement from something particular to a specific time and place to something indiscriminately applicable, it allowed for organisation, analysis and control on a scale undreamt of by our ancestors. And indeed, in the centuries since the metric system was created, it has been abstracted even further. The metre and its fellow metric units are no longer based on anything so crass as the span of the planet. No, they are now defined by constants of the universe itself, on the speed of light and the spin of atoms, unchanging, so far as we know, throughout reality. My journey into the history of measurement has taken me to many places, from the bacon heat of Cairo, where the importance of metrology is catalogued in the stone of the pyramids, to the chilly museum in Uppsala that houses the first ever Celsius thermometer. But it was at the British Library in London that I did most of my work, arriving to read and learn from the countless academics and researchers whose work has enabled my own. Every time I walked to the entrance of the library, I would find my gaze captured by the building's guardian, a cyclopean statue of a man sitting on a stool, bending over to measure something on the ground in front of him. The figure's gaze is intent, his body huge and muscular, and in his outstretched hand he holds a compass that jags like lightning into the earth. I thought the statue a good omen at first. Here was a monument to measurement, to its capability and authority, greeting me every day. But one afternoon, sitting in the courtyard during a lunch break, I idly looked up the monument's history and found a very different explanation of its meaning. The sculpture is from 1995, the work of Italian artist Edoardo Poluzzi, but is modelled on a 1795 watercolour by William Blake, which depicts Isaac Newton in an identical pose. Poluzzi intended the statue to represent a fusion of the humanities and sciences, to embody humanity's search for truth across different disciplines. But Blake had a far sharper critique to make. He was not celebrating the work of the great scientist, but satirizing his blindness. The figure in his watercolor is engrossed in his calculations, yes, but ignorant to the wonders of the world around him also. He is hunched, not heroic, obsessed with his measurements, and so missing entirely what his compass cannot contain. The illustration happened to be one of Blake's favourites, which he reproduced many times over in his life, even tinting the colours of a final copy on his deathbed. It represented one of the great intellectual struggles of his life, his reckoning with Enlightenment ideals of rationality and progress, which seemed to inspire and antagonise him in equal measure. Newton's pose in the watercolour recalls that of another compass-wielding figure in Blake's mythos, the god Urizen, whom Blake represented in his poetry and art as the first deity in existence, the embodiment of law, rationality, and order. Although the name sounds biblical, it seems also to be a surprisingly candid pun on the words, your reason. For the mystic and radical Blake, a man who spoke to angels and championed revolution, Urizen was not a noble presence, but a repressive tyrant, who first weighed and measured the universe, and in so doing imposed limits on the human soul. As Anthony Blunt, art historian and Soviet spy, put it, the effect of Urizen's creation for Blake was to crush man's sense of the infinite and to shut him up within the narrow wall of his five senses. This idea of measurement as repressive force was not what originally caught my attention when I was first enchanted by the redefinition of the kilogram. But as I waded deeper into the history of metrology, this aspect became impossible to ignore. Measurement is unquestionably a tool of control, and as a result, has been used throughout history to manipulate, persecute, and oppress. To measure something, after all, is to impose limits on the world, to say this far, but no further. It means fitting reality into categories that can never capture its full complexity. For when we try to measure some particular aspect of the world, we are inevitably making a choice that reflects our biases and desires. Measurement is a tool that reinforces what we find important in life, what we think is worth paying attention to. The question then of who gets to make those choices is of the utmost importance. These dynamics can play out in very different ways. Some examples of mismeasure may be petty and slight, like the humiliations of workplace bureaucracies, painful in the moment but forgotten easily enough. Others are difficult to fathom in the extent of their cruelty. Consider the horrors of eugenics or scientific racism, movements motivated by ugly notions of racial hierarchy, but justified through the pretend objectivity of measurement conveyed through comparisons of skull sizes and IQ tests. For Blake and his sympathizers, such barbarism is an expected product of the civilized world. The 20th century philosophers Max Horkheimer and Theodore Adorno noted that the entire process of abstraction, of creating generalized rules and categories, is one of the foundations of modernity, for better or worse. It is a product of the same Enlightenment thinking that made Blake shudder and that continues to shape the societies we live in today. Classification is a condition of knowledge, not knowledge itself, and knowledge in turn dissolves classification, they wrote. The world as we know it today is ruled by equivalence, by a desire to reduce everything to number and to make dissimilar things comparable by reducing them to abstract quantities. Or, as the satirist Jonathan Swift put it centuries before, philosophers who find some favourite system to their mind, in every point to make it fit, will force all nature to submit. Perhaps this all sounds like rather a heavy burden to attach to measurement, to accuse tape measures of brutality and scales of injustice. But we regularly turn to measurement to fix the greatest problems in society, whether in healthcare, education, or policing. So why should we be surprised if it is capable of threatening our happiness too? This, I think, is the true beauty of the subject. Its depth is hidden on the surface. Peel back that thin layer of familiarity, and measurement is anything but banal. It is a complex and turbulent force that has shaped history. It has been tutor to humanity and an overlord also. Over time, it has been the concern of gods and kings, and an inspiration to both philosophers and scientists. It is a child's art, practiced with a pencil and ruler, but also the means by which some of humanity's greatest achievements have been orchestrated. In the final reckoning, measurement has left its mark on us all. Chapter 1. The Kindling of Civilization. The Ancient World, the First Units of Measurement, and Their Cognitive Rewards. I have not diminished the palm measure. I have not falsified the cubit of land. I have not added to the weights of the balance. I have not nullified the plummet of the scales. Oath from the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Measuring the abundance of the Nile. We tend to think of measurement as something taken from the world, as knowledge extracted from nature by means of scales, gauges, and rulers. But this framing is just convention, and the opposite is equally true. The measure often precedes the measurement. It is the product of some complex system, perhaps unseen or not yet fully known, that exists prior to our attention and requires effort to be understood. In the same way that high-energy cosmic particles hurtle unscathed through the heads of our ancestors for millions of years before we designed the means to track them, we can think of measures as crowding the universe, innumerable and imperceptible, passing through us like spirits from another dimension. All we need do is devise the means to know them. In the world of ancient Egypt, one particular measure could be found long before people settled the land and would come to define the civilization they built there. The bounty of the Nile, a liquid treasure meted out each year in floodwater and fertility. As Herodotus tells us, Egypt is the gift of the Nile, says Salima Ikram, professor of Egyptology at the American University in Cairo. She and I are bouncing along the streets of Cairo in a battered Soviet-era Lada taxi, and Salima delivers this quote with a wink and a smile, aware of both the smoothness of her patter and the lazy demands of itinerant writers. True to the clichés, as a first-time visitor in Cairo, I feel utterly outmatched by the noise and heat of the city, but even more so by Salima herself, who is small, suave, and irrepressibly sharp. During our time together, she seems to field constant phone calls from friends and colleagues, organising dinners and archaeological digs with equal aplomb and addressing everyone she talks to as sweetie and habibi. When I ask if she's really on such friendly terms with all these people, she laughs and replies, "Oh no, it's just because I can't remember anyone's name." Herodotus was right about the Nile, of course. The river flows down from the south into Egypt from the highlands of present-day Ethiopia, flooding the surrounding plains with unusual regularity. For millennia, it clotted thick, rich mud onto the landscape every summer, and into this sticky terrain, crops could be planted to ripen with minimal watering under the winter sun. By spring, they would be ready for harvest, and as the mud dried and cracked open in the summer heat, excess water and minerals would drain away from the land like a bathtub with the plug pulled out, leaving the fields parched and ready for the cycle to begin again. The ancient Egyptians were acutely aware of the Nile's importance and embedded its presence deep in their culture. The river's annual floods created the three seasons of their calendar: Akhet, or inundation, Peret, or growing, and Shemu, or drought. The floodwaters themselves were deified in the form of Hapi, an androgynous god depicted with a full belly and swollen breasts to signify the abundance he brought to the world. It was the inscrutable will of Hapi that offered the best explanation for the Nile's largesse, and it was thought he released its waters each year from hidden caverns in the mountains. As the floods cascaded down into Egypt, Hapi's spirit would flow across the land, trailed by a frolicking retinue of frogs and crocodiles. The enormous wealth created each year by the arrival of Hapi nurtured a civilization that has lasted for millennia. Even today, the Nile is indispensable to Egypt, providing 95% of the country's water needs. Capturing this abundance required ingenuity. And Salima is taking me to see one of the tools used for this task, an artifact of ancient measurement that is testimony to metrology's role as the kindling of civilization. It is a nilometer, a measuring tool used by the ancient Egyptians to gauge the depths of the Nile's floodwaters each year. These readings were vital, as the depth of flooding determined whether the year's harvest would be slim or bountiful, an insight that powered the operations of the state like the mainspring of a clock. If the nilometers said a famine was coming, then food would need to be set aside to sustain the people and stem unrest. If they predicted the harvest would be plentiful, then appropriate taxes could be levied in the form of crops, labor, and land. These resources then supported the business of the nation, contributing towards trade for silver or copper, rations for the army, and construction projects like the society-warping pyramids. Most importantly, the bounty of a good harvest would be used to fill the granaries that would feed the people in leaner years. But for all these decisions to be made, measurements had to be taken. Appropriately for this singular purpose, nilometers are simple things. In essence, they are just giant rulers carved into columns, walls, or stairs that were themselves within reach of the Nile's waters. Each scale was marked in cubits, an ancient unit of length that was likely invented by the Egyptians before spreading to neighboring cultures. The cubit is equal to the distance from elbow to fingertip. The English name is derived from the Latin cubitum, meaning elbow, and has maintained its familiarity today through widespread use in the Bible. Many different cubits have existed over the millennia, and the Egyptians themselves recognized two varieties, the common cubit of 6 palms and a longer royal cubit of 7 palms. Each palm is divided into 4 fingers, giving a total length for the longer cubit of roughly 52 centimeters or 20 inches. As our taxi dodges in and out of traffic, Salima and I briefly burst from the streets onto a wide bridge that sails over the Nile itself, the air cooling as it streams over water. Salima explains that it's difficult to say for certain how the first nilometers were used, but they were undeniably a key feature of Egyptian life. There were probably hundreds spread across the country, she says, and although we don't know when they were first introduced, it's her guess that they appeared around 3000 BC, when the first of Egypt's dynastic kings began to unify the lands. Even then, people were reliant on the Nile, and one of the reasons we think the whole Egyptian state came about, with the creation of writing and bureaucracy and so on, was to organize access to the water and land, she says. You have to figure out a way of documenting who owns the water and who gets access to it, and that requires the state. Salima and I disembark onto Rhoda Island, one of several large islands in this section of the Nile. We ease ourselves out into the baking heat and approach the gates of the compound where the nilometer resides. This particular example is far from the oldest in Egypt, but it is one of the grandest. It's barely a millennium old and was built in the 9th century AD when Egypt was part of the Islamic Abbasid Caliphate. As Salima chats to a quartet of guards, who have sensibly abandoned their sun-drenched sentry post for a bench in the shade, I look over to the building housing the nilometer a few hundred meters away. A single-story construction, topped by a huge 12-sided roof, the structure positioned at the leading edge of the island, pointing forwards into the Nile like the helmsman of a great ship. Salima buys our tickets, and one of the guards ambles out toward the building ahead of us. It's mid-morning, and we're the first visitors of the day. We stand about while he unlocks the door, and then step, gratefully, out of the heat and down into the stony coolness below. I'm shocked by what we find inside, for although the Nilometer itself is plain, a single octagonal column built into the centre of a well roughly 11 metres deep, the roof above is dazzlingly ornate. 12 symmetrical windows let light and air into the building, and the steeple-like ceiling is covered in a dense pattern of vines, leaves, and flowers, woven together like a verdant tapestry. The colour scheme is gold and green, and it feels like we're standing under the canopy of some mythical jewelled garden. Quietly, Salima slips the guard some money. "I'm keeping a tab, don't you worry," she whispers to me. And he unlocks a private gate for us to descend into the well. Stone steps line the interior, but the absence of a handrail is unnerving, and I press my back flat against the wall for safety. Salima doesn't seem to notice, and meanders down in an unhurried fashion, stopping only to point out some of the more interesting graffiti to me. "Look at this one," she says, indicating carved letters on the wall. 1820, English tourists. Once we've reached the bottom of the well, I regain my equilibrium and take in our surroundings from this new perspective. It's dusty and damp, like the catacombs of an old church, and feels as much like a burrow as a basement. Looking up, I can finally appreciate the full glory of the 12-sided roof, which fills the opening at the top of the well. Positioned just above the apex of the Nilometer's column is a swirling, circular motif that looks like a huge flower or a rising sun. I'm astounded by the beauty of the place. "It's gorgeous," I murmur, and Salima nods emphatically in agreement. "It's absolutely fabulous." As the guard patrols behind the balcony above us, Salima and I chat in the shadows, standing either side of the tall marble measuring column, its millennium-old cubit markings visible as shallow grooves in the stone's surface. "We don't know exactly how measurements from these tools were collated in pharaonic times," says Salima, "how frequently they were read or how long records were maintained, but it's clear that each Nilometer had its recognised readings, both good and bad. In the 1st century AD, when Egypt was under Roman rule, historian Pliny the Elder described how figures taken from a Nilometer thought to be in Memphis, the capital of ancient Egypt, were used to gauge the country's fortunes. When the water rises to only 12 cubits, Egypt experiences the horrors of famine," he wrote. "When it attains 13, hunger is still the result. A rise of 14 cubits is productive of gladness. A rise of 15 sets all anxieties at rest, while an increase of 16 is productive of unbounded transports of joy." This figure of 16 cubits seems to have significance beyond Pliny's recording too. An 18th century statue copied from a 2nd or 3rd century AD original that represents the Nile as a recumbent and muscular figure is surrounded by 16 puti, or cherubs, each a cubit in height to symbolise the ideal flood. Such dedication to these figures may seem unusual, but the Nilometer's readings were not mere trivia. Not only did they reveal whether the year would be spent in grim poverty or easy abundance, but they also reflected something of the country's divine and political fortunes. Religion and government were inextricably linked in ancient Egypt, with the country's priesthood serving as its civil service, overseeing laws, administering resources, and advising the pharaoh, who was himself a semi-divine figure. Spiritual ritual and bureaucratic rigour were therefore both needed to maintain prosperity, and the Nilometers themselves were usually built inside temple complexes. The same priests who read these scales would oversee the religious festivals that celebrated the floods. "The flooding of the Nile and fertility of the land were linked directly to the pharaoh's rule," says Salima. "So, if you get lots of bad floods, that means the gods are pissed off with the pharaoh, and by extension with all of Egypt." In these circumstances, measuring the depth of the Nile seems more than a practical chore. It's a rite that gauges the favour of the gods. As Salima and I stand for a moment in silence at the foot of the well, I nod to a shadowy tunnel in one side of the wall. "Where does that go?" I ask. "That," Salima replies, "goes straight to the Nile. It let the waters into the well when the Nilometer was in use, but it's blocked off now, thankfully." Shall we take a look inside? We take out our phones and turn on their flashlights, shining them into the tunnel like explorers. As we shuffle into the darkness, edging away from the island's centre and closer to the Nile itself, I think about the mass of water flowing unseen over and around us, just metres away behind rock and stone. It's a force that has sustained this land for millennia, and a measurement waiting to be understood. The invention of writing, number, and measure. Measurement was a crucial organising principle in ancient Egypt, but metrology itself does not begin with nilometers. To understand its place in human culture, we have to trace its roots back further to the invention of writing itself. For without writing, no measures can be recorded. The best evidence suggests that the written word was created independently thousands of years ago by a number of different cultures scattered around the world, in Mesopotamia, Mesoamerica, China, and Egypt. But it's in Mesopotamia, present-day Iraq, where the practice is thought to have been invented first. A brief sketch of the origin of writing goes like this. In the beginning, there was the thing, and the thing needed counting. What the thing was doesn't matter much. A flock of sheep, perhaps, or sheaves of barley, profits of the new system of settled agriculture, which had allowed cities with tens of thousands of occupants to appear for the first time in history. The women and men who dwelt in these cities wanted to keep track of their new wealth and decided to use clay tokens for the job. These tiny objects, the size of game pieces, were shaped as cones, discs, triangles, and cylinders, and can be found scattered throughout the archaeological record like errant dice. The earliest date back to 7500 BC, in what would become the Mesopotamian civilization of Sumer, home of the Sumerians. The tokens seem to have been useful, as they multiply in form and number over the centuries. As city life became more varied in Mesopotamia, with inhabitants trading not only raw materials like wool and metal, but also processed goods like oil, beer, and honey, more tokens were created to represent these resources. Their appearance became more complex, with scratches added to their surface, adding a graphic element to their meaning. Fast forward a few millennia, and like a shopper burdened with too much pocket change, the Mesopotamians were fed up with their clutter of tokens. To better organize them, they began making clay containers known as bullae to enclose them into groups. These bullae started appearing around 3500 BC as bumpy spheres the size of tennis balls, filled with clay tokens and sealed like a baby's rattle. One bulla can then be used to track multiple items. This technology had its advantages and disadvantages. If you are, for example, a Sumerian priest recording tributes from farmers, you'd be happy that your clay spheres couldn't be tampered with, but annoyed that you couldn't check their contents without breaking them open. So one day, while making your latest bulla, before you put the tokens inside, you press them firmly onto the clay's wet exterior as a reminder of the contents. It was the work of a moment, but a crucial step, says archaeologist Denise Smant-Besserat, who first recognised the importance of these clay tokens as the precursors of modern writing. It was here, she says, that three-dimensional tokens were reduced to two-dimensional markings, constituting the first signs of writing, and it was a profound cognitive leap. It is the beginning of a new communication system, and certainly had to have reflected something enormous in the brain, she says. It was liberating. Over the centuries, this system evolved. First, instead of impressing tokens onto clay, scribes began tracing their outlines, creating pictographs or pictures of words. Second, realizing that all the information they wanted was now stored on the exterior of the bullae and their contents were redundant, the scribes squashed these clay balls into thick tablets, removing the need for tokens altogether. Third, they began using different signs to signify the item being counted and its quantity. Instead of tracing a pictograph of a jar of oil to represent each jar of oil, they began using separate symbols for what the thing is and how much of it there is. With this change, you have not only the beginning of formal number systems in writing, but also the beginning of measurement. Throughout the course of the 3rd millennium BC, the pictographs on the bullae would morph into increasingly abstract signs. Series of wedges pressed into clay using cut reed that represented syllables and consonants, not just objects. This is the script we know as cuneiform, meaning wedge-shaped, which was used by all the major Mesopotamian civilizations, including the Sumerians and their successors, the Babylonians and Assyrians. By 2500 BC, this writing system had become sufficiently plastic and flexible to express without difficulty the most complicated historical and literary compositions. But from this very early period, we've recovered only a handful of literary texts. Instead, the overwhelming majority of unearthed writing tablets, some tens of thousands, are administrative in purpose. These were composed by a class of professional scribes who were the cohesive force that helped preserve and enrich ancient Mesopotamia, fulfilling duties including temple functionary, court secretary, royal counselor, civil bureaucrat, and commercial correspondent. The library they created is one of receipts, contracts, shopping lists, tax returns, deeds of sale, inventories, wage slips, and wills. Over time, narrative writing like royal announcements and records of war were added to the mix, but even these retain something of the catalogue format, listing provinces conquered, offspring born, and temples consecrated and desecrated. There's some debate over whether this invention of writing enabled the first states to emerge, giving their rulers the ability to oversee and allocate resources, or whether it was the demands of the early states that in turn led to the invention of writing. Either way, the scribal arts offered dramatic new ways to process knowledge, allowing for not only superior organization, but also superior thinking. Some scholars argue that the splitting of noun and number on clay tablets didn't just allow kings to better track their taxes, but was tantamount to a cognitive revolution, a leap forward that allowed humans to abstract and categorize the world around them like never before. Lists may not seem like cognitive dynamite, but their proliferation appears to have helped develop new modes of thought in early society, encouraging us to think analytically about the world. "The list relies on discontinuity rather than continuity," writes anthropologist Jack Goody. "It encourages the ordering of the items by number, by initial sound, by category, etc. And the existence of boundaries, external and internal, brings greater visibility to categories, at the same time as making them more abstract." Think about how spoken language tends to place information in a definite context. When recalling your day, you might say, "I went to the shops and bought eggs, flour, and milk to make pancakes." The list, by comparison, abandons continuity for atomization, removing individual items from a wider narrative. To buy eggs, flour, milk. It fosters what psychologists call chunking, the process of breaking down large quantities of data into manageable subdivisions and measuring out the world in discrete packages. Most of us are aware instinctively of the benefits of this approach. When we are racked by vague terror about tasks yet to be tackled, we often resort to list making, paring down the madness of the world into something that can be managed one job at a time. This categorization of knowledge in early Mesopotamian society is evidenced by what archaeologists call lexical lists, tablets that simply list different classes of objects, like the index of an encyclopedia. The exact function of these lists, which cover everything from types of trees to body parts and the names of gods, isn't entirely clear. They might have been used to teach vocabulary or as practice for scribes, but what they show is ancient humans grappling with the problem of classification. As Goody argues, the process of constructing a thematic list leads to increments of knowledge, to the organization of experience. It is a precursor to organized philosophical systems and, eventually, to science. Centuries later, in the 4th century BC, Aristotle would turn the list format into the bedrock of his thinking by divvying up all of reality in his great work, The Categories. This grand taxonomy draws many arcane distinctions between the eternal mobile substances, the heavens, and the destructible mobile substances, the sublunary bodies. Between the unensouled destructible mobile substances, elements, and the ensouled destructible mobile substances, living beings, and so on. None of the examples of this form prior to the ancient Greeks are anywhere near as philosophically complex, but they are elaborate and beautiful, just the same. One particularly famous example of the form comes from ancient Egypt, and is dated to around 1000 BC, a product of the state's bureaucratic culture that's known as the Onomasticon of Amenope. In its simplest form, the Onomasticon is simply a list of some 610 entries, items that collectively span the known world. An introduction to the text states that it is to be used for instructions of the ignorant and for learning all things that exist, what Ptah created, what Thoth copied down. It begins with the natural world. The first entry is sky, followed by sun, moon, and star, before proceeding through darkness and light, shade and sunlight, and tackling various earthly categories like riverbank, island, sand, and mud. After describing the earth, it moves on to its occupants, beginning with the supernatural, God, goddess, and spirit, before progressing to the most important humans, starting with the royal court, king to queen to king's mother, then through high-ranking civil and military roles, general and deputy of the fortress, and then onto the wider world of work. This is the most granular section, with several hundred entries offering a detailed picture of Egyptian society. It starts with the professional artisans, sculptor, hour keeper, astronomer, before moving on to the lower orders, steersman, herdsman, gardener, and dancer. After the people have been dealt with, there's a section on the towns of Egypt, followed by types of building and terrain. After reaching the ground, we move on to survey its bounty, crops, vegetables, and other foodstuffs for over 100 entries. The list ends when even these items have been broken down into their constituent parts, with the final three entries of raw meat, cooked meat, and spiced meat. As the list's author has promised, we've been shown all the things upon which Ra, the sun god, has shone, taken on a journey, from the cosmic pantheon to the butcher's table, in 610 easy steps. The Egyptologist Alan Gardner, who collated the various manuscripts that make up the text, was unimpressed. Certainly there was never written a book more tedious and less inspired than the Onomasticon of Amenopi, he commented in 1947. But 3 decades later, Goody finds more value in the list, noting how the Onomasticon demonstrates the dialectical effect of writing upon classification to an unparalleled degree. The entire text is a lesson in the power of hierarchy as it blends together the spiritual and terrestrial realms into one great spectrum. Binaries like light and darkness appear as pairs in the list, accentuating their similarities and differences, while transitions between categories are observed with sensitivity. When Jew is listed in the Onomasticon, for example, its placement mirrors the phenomenon itself. It appears on the border between earth and sky, a delicate imprint from one world to the next, like the moisture that gathers on grass with the rising sun. Can a list be poetic? Can taxonomies do more than set their subjects in stone, but also enliven our awareness of them? I certainly believe so. Thousands of years later, in an essay published in 1942, the writer Jorge Luis Borges captured the absurdity and scope of list-making with his own fictional taxonomy, supposedly found in an ancient Chinese encyclopedia titled Celestial Emporium of Benevolent Knowledge. In it, an unknown scribe orders all of the animals of the world into 14 categories. These include those that belong to the emperor, trained ones, suckling pigs, mermaids, those included in this classification, and my personal favourite, those that tremble as if they were mad. The divisions are precise, elegant, and incongruous. As the French philosopher Michel Foucault noted, the celestial emporium shows that lists require subtle thought, the ability to segment, categorize, and compare. These characteristics are a little hidden in ancient texts like the Onomasticon of Amenopi, but Borges hauls them to their feet and sets them dancing. As Foucault says, there is nothing more tentative, nothing more empirical, superficially at least, than the process of establishing an order among things. Nothing that demands a sharper eye or a surer, better articulated language. Divine time. The earliest applications of measurement are not simply concerned with organizational prowess. They are exploratory and curious, a method of interacting with the world that records its rhythms and guides our responses. As demonstrated by the Nilometer's ability to gauge the favor of the gods, such measures have significance beyond the practical, especially in the ancient world, where the workings of nature are more frequently ascribed to divine causes. Because of this, early metrology is often a way of interacting with the supernatural, a connection seen particularly clearly in the origins of the measurement of time. The fundamental unit of time is, of course, the day, the 24-hour period it takes the Earth to complete one rotation on its axis. as the book of Genesis says, there was evening and there was morning, one day. The value of this unit is nothing more than an accident of our planet's rate of spin, set when the Earth first coalesced from a cloud of gas and dust, and slowing down minutely ever since. But it's also a measure that is written into our biology, hard-coded in our DNA as circadian rhythms. This pattern of physiological events coordinates each of our bodies to the spin of the planet that is our home. It suppresses bowel movements in the night, raises alertness at dawn, and secretes melatonin at dusk to prepare us for sleep. Such rhythms exist not only in the animal kingdom, but in plants, fungi.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.